Президент Российской Федерации Владимир Владимирович Путин.
President of the Russian Federation Vladimir Putin.
Спасибо. Спасибо большое. Благодарю вас.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Уважаемые граждане России,
citizens of Russia,
уважаемые члены Совета Федерации и депутаты Государственной Думы, сегодняшнее послание носит особый,
my State of the Nation address today is special.
В которое мы живем, когда значимость нашего выбора,
That's because they define the future of our country for decades. It is at such turning points that Russia has always demonstrated its capability to develop and renew, to build new cities, to conquer space, to make tremendous discoveries. This pursuit of the future, this combination of traditions and values, is what makes our history so strong. We went through difficult transformations. We coped with extreme difficulties in the economy and the social sphere. We kept our country together. We established ourselves firmly as a democracy. We ensured stability in practically all the different areas of our life, which is critical for our multinational large country with its federative structure, different cultures, historical conflicts in our past, and different tribulations we had in the past. Stability is a firm foundation, but it doesn't guarantee further development. We can't afford this stability to make us relax and sit back. We still have many problems that remain unresolved. Russia still has a vast economic and defensive potential, but we need to improve the quality of our people's lives. We're not there yet, but we have to get there, and this is what we are going to do.
The role,
the positions of a state in the world today is defined not by natural resources or productive capabilities. It's defined by people, by conditions for self-fulfillment for every person. So, our top priority is to preserve the people of Russia, to ensure their welfare. This is where we need to achieve our biggest breakthrough. And like I said, we've laid the foundation for that. So now we can go to another level and address new challenges. We have some experience with implementing large-scale projects and programs. Our economy is stable, and this provides us with new opportunities for breakthroughs and long-term growth. Finally, there is huge technology potential in the world today that enables us to achieve a real breakthrough in improving the quality of life for our people, developing our infrastructure and governance. How effectively we'll be able to take advantage of this technology revolution, how we are going to respond to these challenges, it's all up to us. So, the upcoming years will determine the future of our country, will determine the future of Russia. Why? Let me explain something to you. And this has nothing to do with the electoral cycle, with the upcoming presidential election. Whoever becomes the next president, regardless of that, every person, every citizen of Russia has to realize what is happening in the world today and what kind of challenges we face today. Technological changes are happening at an increasing speed. And those who take advantage of this new technology will launch forward. Those who are unable to do that will be buried under this tide of technological progress. Being backward technologically means undermining the capabilities of your country and eventually losing your sovereignty. That's a fact. This will weaken the country, undermine its human potential, because new jobs, modern companies, appealing prospects will emerge in other countries, in successful countries, and young people will go there, talented people will move there, and society will lose its vitality and development potential as a result. Like I said, we are witnessing civilizational changes in the world today, and this requires us to rise up to this challenge, and we are ready for that. We are ready for this breakthrough. My confidence is based on results we have achieved so far, which are quite obvious, things we have achieved together. We've consolidated the people of Russia, and we have a huge potential. Our people are extremely creative. For us to move forward and develop dynamically, we need to expand the space of freedom in all the different areas. We need to strengthen democratic institutions, local self-government, civil society, the judiciary. We have to be open to the world, open to new ideas and new initiatives. We have to embrace long overdue decisions. We have to make those decisions. We need to abandon everything that stops us, holds us back, preventing people from fulfilling themselves and developing. We need to concentrate and focus. We need to be strong and work hard. But otherwise, we'll have no future. Our children will have no future. Our country will have no future. I don't mean necessarily that somebody will invade us. No, we'll be lagging behind. This is the biggest threat. And unless we do something, the situation will only get worse. This is like a chronic disease that gradually undermines your body from within. Sometimes you don't even feel it. We need to focus on development so that no obstacle prevents us from making progress. It's up to us to define our future. Colleagues, what should be our priority? Like I said, I think the welfare of our people is our top priority. In the year 2000, we had 42 million people living below the poverty line. This is almost 30% of our population, 29% to be exact. In 2012, we reduced this number to 10%. Then, because of the economic crisis, poverty went up again. Today, we have 20 million of our people living below the poverty line. Of course, that's not 40 million like we had in the year 2000, but it's still unacceptable. Even some working people live in very modest conditions. For the first time in our modern history, we were able to raise minimum wages to the minimum living wage. And this will go into effect on May 1st of 2018. This will affect the incomes of 4 million people. This is an important step, yet it doesn't resolve the problem entirely. We need to renew our employment system, which is quite archaic today. We need to provide people with jobs that motivate them, provide income, and help with self-fulfillment. We need to create modern, high-paying jobs. This is the foundation that that we need to address in the coming decade: sustainable long-term growth of personal incomes. Over the next 6 years, we need to reduce the number of people living below the poverty line by at least 50%. We need to revise our system of social benefits. Those benefits should go to families who really need it. In the past by supporting families, mothers, we were able to overcome negative demographic trends. We've increased the birth rate and we've reduced the mortality rate. We were able to overcome the consequences of two demographic downturns after World War II and towards the end of the previous century. You can see on the graphic these two downturns look very similar in terms of numbers. But what we lost in the 90s shows today there's a decrease in the birth rate.
Начинает создавать малочисленное поколение 90-х годов.
Currently, we have a small number of people who were born in the 90s marrying. There's also an economic dimension to this problem. In 2017, the number of working people reduced by a million, and this trend will continue within the next few years. This can become a serious limitation for economic growth. We just don't have labor resources. We need to respond to this challenge, and in coming decades, we need to make sure that the population of Russia keeps growing. We continued our policy, we've extended the maternity benefit program, and we have targeted the payouts for the first child, second and third child over the next 5 years. Over 500,000 families with children will be able to improve their living conditions by getting a better deal on mortgage. We also have a program for children hospitals. Despite certain remaining problems, we've resolved the problem with kindergartens. Now we need to provide all families that need arrangements for even younger children. We need to help young moms to go back to work if they are interested in doing so. In 3 years, we have to create 270,000 new places in nurseries. We'll support our provinces. We'll provide 50 billion rubles from the federal budget to this program. Over the next 6 years, the government will spend at least 3.4 trillion rubles to the programs of supporting family and maternity and population growth. This is a large amount of money, but it's not exorbitant. This is 40% more than we used to spend in 2016 and 2017. We spent 2.47 trillion rubles. It is our moral obligation to support the older generation as well, because these people made a major contribution to the development of our country. Senior citizens should have all the necessary conditions for longevity and proper aging. We need to increase pensions and regularly index pensions above inflation. We will also do our best to close the gap between, to reduce the gap between pensions and the salary that the person used to have before retirement. We also need to improve the quality of medical services provided to senior citizens, and we need to help people who find themselves in a difficult situation. This would require a comprehensive approach on our part. I think that the future government, the future cabinet, should prepare a special program for systemic support to improve the quality of life for senior people. We appreciate every person. Every person matters to us. We want all people to live long and healthy life, to see their grandchildren and great-grandchildren, to see how their grandchildren become young, energetic, positive people, moving their country forward. Russia should secure its place among the top five economies and increase GDP by 50% over the next 2 years. This is a serious task, but I'm sure that we will be able to achieve this goal.
важнейший базовый показатель благополучия.
Another key basic indicator is longevity, life expectancy. In the year 2000, life expectancy was a little over 65 years in Russia, and for males it was under 60. This is not just low, this is a real tragedy.
Последние годы темп роста средней продолжительности жизни в России одни из самых высоких в мире.
Russia achieved one of the best life expectancy growth rates in the world. We increased the life expectancy by over 70 years. We moved it up to 73, but even this is not enough. Today, we have to set a new goal. By the end of the next decade, Russia should join the club of countries with 80 plus life expectancy. These include countries like Japan, France, and Germany. Life expectancy should grow by increasing the period where people are not affected by diseases, where they can live healthy lifestyle. And this is doable. This is possible. Our entire country will have to make a big step towards this goal. The lives of all of our people have to change for that. Colleagues, we have to create a modern environment for our people. We need to transform our cities and villages while we preserve our historical heritage. And we have successful experience of improving urban environment. We have such experience in Kazan, in Vladivostok, in Sochi. Many provincial capitals are also being transformed, so we've got some experience for that. So I suggest we launch a new large-scale program that will affect many other major cities as well, and we should at least double our spending on these programs over the next 6 years. Clearly, developing cities and settlements involves health care, education, transport, infrastructure. All these things will require additional funding as well. I will talk about this a little later in different sections of my address. We need to improve urban development based on using new materials in construction, modern architectural solutions. We should use digital technology for transport, utility system, and so on. This will make the whole system of the utility services transparent. People should get quality services without overpaying for them. This will create new prospects for our people, provide them with modern environment for civic initiatives, small businesses, and startups. This will help Russia develop a vibrant middle class. A lot will depend on the municipal authorities, how open they are to modern, new ideas, how well they respond to initiatives coming from people, low-income families, disabled people. They should really care about their cities, towns, people who live there. And this is not a formality. I really mean it. And I would ask authorities at all levels to pay special attention to this, developing our cities. This should be the locomotive of our development today. We cannot focus on just a few big cities. Big city should be a foundation for well-balanced spatial development of the entire country. This requires modern infrastructure, and I will talk about this a little later in detail. But Right now, I would like to stress that well-developed infrastructure would provide our people with all the necessary services that the residents of big cities enjoy today. Those people living in rural areas should be integrated with the rest of the country. We will support initiatives that provide small towns, help them preserve their identity, and develop will pay special attention to social and infrastructure development in rural areas. The agricultural industry is already competitive on the global stage, and people who provided this success should see real improvements in their lives accordingly. Colleagues, I understand how important it is for every family to have a house, to have a residence. This is a huge problem that we have inherited from our past. It has been going on for decades, and we've heard many promises and attempts to solve this problem, and now we are finally able to actually do this, and we should do this. In 2017, 3 million families in Russia improved their living conditions. Now we need to achieve steady, and this is the first time in Russia's modern history, for the first time we should achieve the level where every year at least 5 families will be improving their living conditions. This is a difficult task to go from 3 million to 5 million. This year, last year, we had 3.1 million families, and we need to get to the figure of 5 million people, but this is doable. And there are three key factors that would help us make living more affordable and accessible. First, we need to improve personal incomes. Second, we need to reduce mortgage rates. And third, we need to increase the number of offers on the market. Let me remind you that in 2001, how many mortgage loans were issued in our country? Just 4,000 loans, 4,000 mortgage loans with the interest rate up to 30%, including some in dollars. And actually, 50% of those loans were in dollars. It's just a small group of people who could afford mortgage. Last year, we had 1 million mortgage loans. In December, the average rate went below 10% for the first time ever. Of course, we know that it's a highly individual situation. But we need to proceed in reducing mortgage rates to 7 or 8%. You know, we had a lot of discussion. What should I mention? 7 or 8% when we discussed my speech. But I would like to say that we should definitely aspire to getting this figure down to 7%. Mortgage should become affordable for most working people in Russia today, young specialists, young professionals. Let me give you a few more figures. In the 1950s, 1970s, we had on the average 60 million square meters of new housing in the country. Then in the 80s, it was closer to 70 million. Currently, we have about 80 million square meters. We went a little bit higher on some years. Now we should set our goal higher. We should increase residential construction to 120 million square meters a year. This is an ambitious goal. But again, it's doable, considering new technology and experience that our construction companies have acquired. New materials. We need to get from 80 million to 120 million. It is necessary and it is doable. If we want to have 5 million families improving their living conditions in a year, we need to build 120 million square meters of housing every year. People who invest their money in construction should be protected. We should gradually abandon investment schemes. It should be banks and other institutions assuming risks for construction projects, not individuals.
когда некоторые, в том числе сидящие в этом зале,
you know, when some of our colleagues, including some of them sitting here in this room, and they said that we should use market-based evaluations. They said the system we had in the past are obsolete, but eventually it turned out that quite often we have a situation where housing is evaluated above its market price. So we need to look at our taxation system, how the value of the residence is estimated. It should never be above market value, and we need to make all necessary decisions very soon, in the first 6 months of 2018, no later. Colleagues, to develop our cities and villages, we need to increase business activities. And, this requires that Russia should be covered by modern communications. In just a few months, the Crimean Bridge will be open for automobile traffic, and then it will open for railway traffic in 2019. This will provide an impetus for Crimea to develop and in the entire Black Sea coast. We've renovated our roads. We need to move on to regional roads now. Federal roads are actually much better now. The situation is a little worse with regional roads. Local roads, of course, are a disaster. I would like to appeal to mayors and governors. You need to be focused on road quality of your roads all the time. You need to use new technology, new solutions, infrastructure, mortgage loans, cycle contracts, and so on. And of course, we need to increase safety on our roads. We need to reduce the mortality rate for traffic accidents. Over the next few years, we need to double our spending on road construction and maintenance in Russia. We need to earmark over 11 trillion rubles from different sources for this purpose. This is a lot, considering that in 2017 we spent 6.4 trillion rubles on that. That's a lot too, but we need to bring it up to 11 trillion. We're building roads that will become part of the Russia-Asia-Pacific corridor, and our partners from Kazakhstan and China have already done their part of this project. Their roads are already operational, so we need to accelerate and do our part. We need to increase the throughput capacity of the Baikal-Amur line up to 150 million containers. The time period for delivery over this line should be reduced to 7 days. And this will secure a quick return on investment for this project. Our railroad should increase the throughput capacity by 4 times. This will make Russia one of the world leaders for container transit between Europe and Asia. In 1991, the seaports of the entire Soviet Union were at 600 million tons. But we lost half of that because of the disintegration of the Soviet Union in the early 2000s. It was 300 million tons. Then we increased it by the factor of 3 over the next 17 years. And in 2017, the seaports of Russia passed the mark of 1 billion tons. You can see this on the chart. This is more than what we had in the entire Soviet Union by more than two-thirds. Actually, it's higher than that now. It's 1.25. We should keep increasing, keep developing this potential. We need to increase railway communications in the areas around the seaports. We need to develop the Arctic, and the Northern Sea Route will really help with that. Throughput capacity will increase by a factor of 10 to 80 million tons. We need to make this a competitive transit artery. In the Soviet times, it was used more than later, and we will fix that. We will develop our forests, we will create all the necessary conditions for people to live there in comfortable conditions. We want people to go there. We want to increase the population of forested territories. We've launched a number of important projects in the Arctic regions. They meet modern green standards. We strengthen our scientific capabilities, defense infrastructure in the Arctic regions. This will secure Russia's interest in this strategic part. We're also building nuclear icebreakers, our Arctic fleet has always been and will always be the most powerful Arctic fleet in the world.
We are to reconstruct and expand the network of our regional airports. In 6 years, half of all regional flights will be direct. And the situation when you have to fly to a neighboring region through Moscow, that will be a thing of the past. We are working on it today. Same goes for the aviation, for infrastructure. Based on the strategy for the wide-scale development, we need to prepare a complex set of measures for enhancing the whole infrastructure every that is one of the top priorities for the next government. We should be not only a hub of our planet, we should be one of the world centers for storing, processing, and transferring the data, the so-called big data. On the overall account, developing our infrastructure, we should take into account the global technological changes and trends. Today, we should be introducing new solutions to our project, which would allow us to combine the current infrastructure with the unmanned vehicles and navigation. With the help of the artificial intelligence, we can arrange the logistical management systems, as well as we should work on the generation, transfer, and storage of energy. In the upcoming 6 years, we should renew our energy sector, attracting over 1.5 trillion rubles of private investments, and we should reintroduce the so-called distributed generation of energy to help the far regions of Russia. By the year 2024, we will ensure almost 100% of internet coverage for every corner of Russia. Will complete the construction of the fiber channels for the internet to every remote city and town of Russia, for 25,000 people of Russia. The remote cities and towns of the Far East and Siberia North will have a reliable access through the Russian satellite network. Thanks to the modern telecommunication technologies, we will make our citizens able to connect with the most modern services, educational programs, or TV, internet healthcare services. But the people will be able to create some scientific research, volunteer groups, companies, movements, which would benefit our huge country. That kind of competence and that kind of storage of information and data and talents would be a huge asset. Colleagues, the utmost task for us, which is common for all of us, is the accessibility of high quality and modern healthcare. We should be oriented towards the highest global standards in that field.
2019-2024,
we will be investing annually
4%
of our GDP in this field, but we should be reaching the level of 5% of GDP coming to healthcare services.
В абсолютном выражении это будет
означать,
что общие объемы расходов на здравоохранение должны увеличиться вдвое.
Of twice as high as we have today, we should find new ways to finance the projects, which would not be limited, would not be limiting the economic growth. I would like to thank our doctors, nurses, for the hard work they do, the hard but so very much needed. These are the people on whom our country depends, as well as the teachers and the cultural workers, and they deserve good payment, good salaries and wages.
We've
done a lot when implementing the May orders initiated in 2012. Still, we haven't implemented everything, but generally speaking, they set the high bar. But without that high bar, we wouldn't have the results we have today. We need to be ambitious.
И здесь нельзя отступать от уже достигнутых
рубежей. We should maintain the level of salaries.
Должен расти и дальше.
When it comes to the budget dependent workers, we should see the incremental growth, as well as the growth in the quality of education of people who work in these sectors of healthcare, education. Throughout the recent years, we've modernized our healthcare infrastructure and hospitals. So that is that has a direct impact on the quality of the healthcare services. Overall count. We are too much into the administrative reformations. We are closing smaller hospitals in remote cities, but we have no alternative, and people have no access to such services in remote places. They see no option, and they are being told, you can go to the city and some help there, but this means that people are forgotten and abandoned. We should present equal opportunities, fair services. It shouldn't be the case in healthcare or anywhere else. We need to restore truly stage-by-stage accessibility for most basic healthcare services. We should have done that in the first place when working on the reforms. We should do that today, as soon as possible. For the sake of the cities who are not more than 100,000 people, and this and the next year, we should be creating new hospitals and first aid centers. And for the towns with less than 100 people, and we have a fair amount of such villages, we need to create mobile services with cars, off-road cars, with all the necessary equipment
for diagnosing.
We need to keep our hands on the pulse
and
ask the All Russian National Front to be in constant contact with the people, monitoring the situation in the field, the hospitals, the regional institutions for healthcare services, and the leading medical research centers should be tied into one and the same network so that the people would get the help from the overall system, every specialist and doctor. Preventing diseases is also important. In the 90s, we did not conduct any of such things. We started to restore the disease prevention policies. Every person in Russia should be coming through a compulsory check every year. That means that we should be more responsible about our health. Modern technologies would allow us to decrease the mortality in the elderly ages and help to prevent many cardiovascular diseases. We have some positive dynamics. That's good. But still, we need to fight off the oncological diseases, the cancer. We need to fend it off, our colleagues. We have our family members or friends who've suffered by that sickness. evil by cancer. And I say we should create an all-Russian program to fight cancer and ecological diseases, bringing in the science potential and our pharmaceutical companies, modernizing our oncological centers, and this way starting to work from the very bottom when we detect the first signs of cancer to the very treatment of it. We have already some positive developments on that track. Across the board, across all the indicators, you know that very well, we should be at the same modern level as others, and that level should be the top one in Russia. Not to maintain a healthy nation, we need to work more than only on the healthcare services in Russia, the country. We need to ensure high levels of environmental protection and well-being. You can imagine a healthy life without millions, with millions of people drinking the water which is below the standards. If you have black snow coming down, like in Krasnoyarsk, and a huge industrial center because of the fog, they cannot see the sun for months in Chelyabinsk, Nizhny Tagil, Cheripovets, and some other cities. We have tightened up our environmental policies for the industry, which will decrease the emissions. Starting with 2012, we expect that as many as 300 industrial complexes will be coming onto the use of new technologies and new emission reduction systems. And starting from the year 2021, every industrial entity in Russia will introduce these new measures and mechanisms. Of course, we've seen many difficulties on the way, but there is no way back. You should know that. We will never postpone the deadlines anymore. We'll not expand the current programs. Also, we need to modernize the energy sector. This will be achieved through creating new roads and highways and enhancing the quality of transportation emissions control. Today, the civil society found out that in Russia there are more than 22,000 dump sites. We need to settle this problem. We need to eliminate the dump sites within the borders of cities. We need to enhance the quality of water in remote small towns. The water is being delivered not 24/7, but only several hours per day. We need to introduce more technologies which are already yielding results in our defense and technical industries. We need to maintain and preserve the unique environment of Baikal, of the Volsky Basin and the Teletsky Lake, which will have a direct positive impact on the quality of life of the half of all Russian citizens. We are to open 24 new preservation centers and national parks. They should be accessible for the environmentally friendly tourism. That will help us to bring up people who are responsible about the environment. Colleagues, 2018 is the year of volunteers. It's very symbolic that this year started with adopting a law which introduces that every level of government and authorities should facilitate the work of volunteers. Today, volunteers, those who are socially oriented, actively participate in solving the most burning task today. And that involvement of people in the work of the authorities, as well as the moral heritage, is what makes our one and the same nation, that was helping us to make headway. We should preserve our identity even amid the technological changes we experience, and you cannot overestimate the role of culture, which is our old national civilizational code we share. It opens up the creativity, positive creativity in every one of us. We should create more cultural and museum institutions across Russia, concert halls, theatrical halls, music halls, and many other schools and institutional halls, as well as exhibition areas, where the leading museums of Russia will be deploying all what they have on display. We should not be storing that in the archives. They should be displaying the beauties they have. These will be the centers for cultural life, for the youth, for the people of all ages, then the first project of that kind will be implemented in Vladivostok. Other cities will follow. Colleagues, our children are dreaming of Russia, which will be oriented towards the future. Essays include many, many words about the dreams of our children, and we should dream about bigger things. We should open up the talents of our children, help them achieve what they want, and it is the school which is responsible for answering the call of times, because only this way the country will be ready to face the challenges of today. Experts say that our school is one of the leading in the world. We will continue the work on enhancing the quality of our education at all levels. And modern, high-quality education should be accessible to every child in Russia. Equal opportunities is a huge potential for the country to achieve greater social justice and equality. We need to transit to more to new technologies of individual education so that the people from a very young age will be ready to creatively search for new information and new skills. We need to build up the competences for the digital age. We need to support talented, gifted pupils and students and teachers as well. And we should create an open system of selection for preparing the personnel and the heads of schools, because they are responsible for enhancing the quality of the teachers and human potential. We'll continue to reinforce our system of support for the gifted children. That kind of system should encompass every region of Russia. We should integrate such platforms as Kvantorium in Syria, the Center for Extracurriculum Education. That should be the case for every region of Russia. We need to create a modern center of professional orientation courses. Universities should pair up with schools and successful companies, and starting with the new school year, we should launch the early professional orientation program, like a ticket to the future, window to the future, that will help our children, our youth, to try their skills in the companies, in the real companies which work today. And we are to allocate 1 billion rubles to support that initiative. Also, it is important to work on coaching, because coaching is what helps us to unite moral foundations and the skills and competences of generations, and mentorship is the answer to the problems we're facing. A very competitive thing is the knowledge, competence, technologies. They are the keys to a breakthrough in enhancing the quality of life. In the immediate future, we should create a modern legal, legislative basis, lifting of every barrier for robotics, for the use of robots, artificial intelligence, unmanned vehicles, e-trade, big data, and such legal framework should be updated on a regular basis. It should be based on the flexible approach to every sector, to every technology. We have all the necessary prerequisites to introduce as fast as possible the 5G networks and the Internet of Things technologies. Just as well, we need to create our own digital platforms, which will be compatible with the global informational platforms, which would allow us to have a new kind of technological order, logistics, and everything else, because distributed register technology is the answer for the challenges of the way to transactions, and it's a very practical thing. We need to create new technologies and new solutions to discover the rich resources of the Arctic and to develop the potential of every our industry, also enhancing the quality of services which are provided to the people who need to have an access to rehabilitation. We need to see more startups to introduce new technologies to the industries. Here we're speaking about a very comfortable taxation and infrastructure,
техническом регулировании и венчурном финансировании.
Rights and venture investments. Our technological growth should be based on the fundamental science potential. Throughout the years, we increased that potential, and across the board, we are now one of the top countries in the world, thanks to the Russian Academy of Science, largely the leading research institute of Russia. Basing our experience and competences, we need to come to the new level today. In Gatchin and Dubna, we see projects for modern research installations of the mega science level. And also in Novosibirsk, we have planned to create a synchrotron installation, as well as the same kind of installation will be installed in the area of Moscow. And Russian research institutions this way will be one of the leading ones in the world. And the use of these new capabilities will allow our companies to be more competitive in creating new drugs, new materials, new chips and motherboards and everything else. And that kind of new infrastructure will support the ambitious scientific research, attracting our compatriots from abroad back to Russia. We need to have a proper legal and contractual basis for the work of international scientific research groups. Our potential should be enriched when it comes to the educational centers. We should be integrated with the institutions, universities, high-tech companies. Such centers are already being created in Kazan, in Samara, and Tomsk, and Novosibirsk, and Yekaterinburg, and Tumen, in Vladivostok, Kaliningrad, and other cities of Russia. We need to orient them towards the implementation of huge interdisciplinary projects in such a promising area as genome research, because the breakthrough on that track will help us to create new methods for prevention of diseases and treatment of diseases, expanding our capabilities in terms of agricultural development. And also, our mathematicians are the ones who are to push forward our digital growth. We have the necessary mathematical research centers in Kazan and Novosibirsk. They're working successfully, and in the framework of the decisions we've made, we are to open the same centers in St. Petersburg, Moscow, and in Sochi just as well. Our youth. Russian youth is proving that they are capable of being the leaders in many spheres. Our school students and pupils have been awarded with 38 medals, achieving the first place at the World Skills Competition 2017. Our students have claimed 12 victories during the competition for programmers. Best practices and experience is what can help us to modernize the professional education. We need to achieve new levels of student education when it comes to the new technologically demanding areas. We should introduce the applicable bachelor's degrees and new courses for engineers, as well as we should create new centers for advanced qualification enhancement courses for those who already work. Also, we need to create favorable environment for our youth, talented and gifted, as well as the youth from other countries will be willing to join our universities. We need to create the environment for the students from abroad to come to Russia for the sake of education, and then they should stay in Russia. We should make it attractive enough for them. We need to enhance the procedure for granting the citizenship to foreign. Yes, we should focus our attention on those who are needed, the young, the healthy, the well-educated. They should enjoy a simplified procedure for citizenship acquisition. Colleagues, to ensure a breakthrough in growth, put our educational healthcare onto a new level together with the infrastructure and services quality, we need to allocate huge amounts of budget money towards these sectors. We need to find additional money. But how are we going to do that? What will be the sources? Where will we find the necessary amounts of money? First and foremost, we should single out our priorities, enhancing the quality and the efficiency of our work, attracting private investments to major projects, and the future government will need to create a new taxation framework which would be stable and cemented for the several years to come. I would like to highlight the fact that we need new fiscal solutions which would help us to improve the budget income, together with the guarantee that we will allocate enough to stimulate the growth, at the same time implementing all our social obligations, the economic growth of Russia.
We need to develop Russia's economic potential, develop the potential of every province. This is the source of further growth. We need our economy to grow above the world's average rate. This is not an easy task, but this is not just wishful thinking. This is a basic requirement for achieving a breakthrough in addressing our economic, infrastructural, and defensive goals. This should be the top priority for the next government. We've stabilized our economy. We are less dependent now on energy prices and their volatility. We have increased our international reserves. Inflation is at an all-time low, a little over 2%. Of course, we realize that for a number of products, prices keep growing above the average rate, and we need to keep an eye on that. Now, I'm referring to our anti-monopoly service. But on the whole, of course, this low inflation offers additional opportunities for us for development. In 2015, just recently, the inflation rate was almost 13%. 12.9 to be exact. Currently, Russia has a new macroeconomic reality with low inflation and general stability of the economy. For people, this offers opportunity to increase their personal incomes. And for businesses, this offers predictability and cheaper loans. So businesses should get accustomed to this new economic reality as well. And finally, this makes it possible to attract long-term loans for large-scale infrastructure projects. So now we can keep inflation low, act responsibly, and at the same time gradually reduce the interest rate, making loans more easily accessible. I hope that the Bank of Russia will support me here as we implement our Implementing its monetary policy, I expect the bank to work in contact with the government towards our common goal, creating conditions for further economic growth, to change the structure of our national economy to make it more competitive. We need to use a fundamentally new approach for our sources of growth. Where are those sources? First, we need to increase our productivity. We are still lagging behind in this respect. We need to increase productivity at major and middle-sized companies, industrial construction, agriculture, trade, commerce, so on. We need growth rate of at least 5% a year. Then, by the end of the next decade, will be among the world's leading economies. Increasing productivity means increased salaries as well. This means that demand will grow, and this in turn will provide an additional driver for economic development. We should motivate companies to produce technologically sophisticated goods. We need to revise our system of subsidies and retarget them to stimulate production of sophisticated goods. Next, attracting investment. We had a goal of increasing it to 25% of GDP, and we were unable to achieve this goal, unfortunately, but we still have to get there at any cost. I hope that the next government and the Bank of Russia will present a specific program on how to get there. We need to modernize our production facilities. We need to get to a level where, on the average, every other company modernizes its production lines in a year. Then we'll see specific results from modernization. The third source of growth is developing small and medium-sized businesses. Over the next decade, its contribution to Russia's GDP should approach 40%, and employment levels should go from 19 to 25 million people. One of the key problems that businessmen are concerned about is access to financial resources. Currently, the government has a special program for small production companies to get loans at 6.5%. I think we should continue this program, and we need to make this instrument really available to businessmen. And another source of growth. This is developing non-commodity exports. We need to remove all administrative barriers and create the most favorable regime for companies that export goods. Over the next 6 years, we have to double our non-commodity exports to $250 billion. We should increase engineering products to $50 billion in exports, $100 billion rubles in tourism, medical services, and so on. In the early 90s, we depended highly on food imports. Now the situation is drastically different. We now have to take the next step. Over the next 4 years, we plan to export more food items than we import. We need to work on beef and processed foods. We need to supply Russia with beef, vegetables, and dairy products. Agricultural developments, of course, relies on the big companies, but this should not impinge smaller businesses and people who work there. We need to support family farms, support farmers. We need to develop agricultural cooperatives, create necessary conditions in rural areas. But, of course, we all know that we have certain problems every now and then that involve people's interests. We should pay close attention to such situations. But once again, I would like to thank our farmers and the workers of the agricultural industry for the bump crop we had this year, 134 million tons. This is more grain than the record for the Soviet Union. This was in 1978. They had their record crop of 127.4 million tons of grain in 1 year. And these days, we regularly have crops over 100 million tons. Of course, there's a downside to such crops. Prices go down. There are problems with storage and transporting grain. To support our producers, we've introduced lower tariffs for railroad transportation of grain until July 1st, 2018. We need to consider similar measures for the future. And we should help with purchasing grain in remote areas like the Urals, in areas that are far from seaports. We need to create added value you need to offer your products to animal farms. We will certainly discuss these issues with the agricultural workers at the agricultural forum that we'll have in March. And based on that, we will come up with additional support measures for the agricultural industry. Colleagues, for the economy to work at its full capacity, we need to improve the business climate. We need to ensure the highest level of business freedoms and competition. The rate of government involvement in the economy should steadily decrease in recent years due to improvements in the banking sphere, and I really support this process. Government acquired a number of financial assets, but we should market those and sell them off. We should get rid of everything that helps corrupted people in the government institutions and law enforcement to put pressure on businesses. The criminal code should no longer be used as a tool in economic disputes. Such disputes should go through administrative and court resolution. I would ask to set up a working group that would include the Supreme Court, prosecution service, representatives of the business community, and come up with specific proposals on this subject, because you cannot resolve such matters straight away, but we certainly need to consider the situation and come up with certain solutions, and we need to do this as soon as possible. At the same time, criminal law should be applied relentlessly to those who violate personal rights and property rights, friendly takeovers, unfair competition, tax evasion, embezzlement, and such things. And other important subjects, inspections. On the one hand, the number of inspections has been reduced, but this is a formality. When we talk to businessmen, they tell us that the situation hasn't really changed. An inspection should be a rare occasion. This should only apply to high-risk places. In other places, we should have a system of remote control. And for the future, we need to implement a risk-oriented inspection system. We need to support up-and-coming businessmen, help people to make their first step. They should be able to start a company with one click, get a loan remotely through the internet. Self-employed people who use digital services should should be able to register automatically. Businessmen who use cash registered should enjoy a facilitated regime of reporting. These seem like routine things, but these are the things that stop them from developing further. We need to do our best to remove all, get rid of all the red tape. Introduction of digital platforms and technology will make this system more transparent. I would like to appeal now to all Russian businessmen, to people who have family, farms, small companies, innovative companies, or maybe a large industrial facility. I know we still have a lot of things that we need to do, and I assure you, we'll do our best to make sure that our businessmen have all the necessary opportunities for developing their companies and creating new jobs. But at the same time, I really expect that Russian business people will also make a greater contribution to breakthrough development of our country. And people will respect businessmen more. This is also very important. Colleagues, in addition to developing modern services for business people, we need to make this whole system more comfortable, transparent, and easier to understand. The whole system of interaction between the government and people, between the government and our citizens. We've created a network of centers where you can go and get government services through one-stop system, one-desk system. And now we need to take the next step. Over the next 6 years, all government services should be available in real time remotely. We should also digitalize document circulation between government institutions. This would be important both for government institutions and for people, so they don't have to run between two places. You can get everything at one place. Digitalization of the entire system of governance, making it more transparent, will also help us to fight corruption. Government officials at all levels should be interested in increasing their efficiency. They should pursue specific results. You know, we keep talking about corruption, but government officials, I have to say this, most government officials, most public servants are good, result-oriented people. But what I just said will help everybody, those who work in the government service, and also people who use government services. We need to revamp the entire system of government services based on project-oriented method of work. Of course, we need to provide personnel for government services, for business, science, production, facilities in all different areas. We had the first Leaders of Russia contest, and we have other initiatives to support young professionals, volunteers, college students, high school students, that they bring together thousands of young people from all over Russia. This is an important step in their lives, in their professional careers. I'd like to emphasize one thing. For all those who want to work and who want to serve their country, their people, for those, Russia will always be a land of opportunity. This is the strong foundation of our further development. All the priorities I mentioned today, spatial development, investing in infrastructure, education, health care, environment protection, new technologies, science, supporting young talented people, all that pursues one strategic goal – breakthrough development of Russia. At the same time, of course, we should not forget about security. Colleagues, we see increased opportunities with the armed forces. Today, we've done a lot to strengthen our army and our navy. Our armed forces are equipped with modern weaponry today. The level of the rate of modern weaponry increased by 3.7 times. We've adopted 300 new models of weaponry, providing our armed forces with 80 new ICBMs, 102 submarine-based ballistic missiles. We've commissioned three new nuclear submarines of the Borei class. 12 ballistic missile regiments have been equipped with Yars missiles. We've increased the number of high-precision long-range missiles by the factor of 12. Aerospace forces, our ground forces, and our navy have significantly increased their capabilities. The entire country, the entire world is familiar today with the names of our newest air defense systems, fighter jets, land-based systems. These are new high-precision weapon systems developed in recent years. Russia's borders, and this is very important, we have a network of radars
сделан качественный рывок в развитии беспилотной
авиации. We had the system during the Soviet years, but then after the Soviet Union disintegrated, it was lost. Now we were able to restore it. We have now a new command in the Far East. The number of conscript soldiers increased by 2.4 times, and we've increased the our military units are now manned at over 90%. The waiting period for military housing has been reduced by a factor of 6. And now the most important thing for this section, for defense, I'll talk about our newest systems of strategic weaponry that we have created as our response to the U.S. unilaterally withdrawing from the ABM treaty and deploying this system in the U.S. and also in other countries around the world. I would like to go back to history. In 2000, the United States told us about its plans to withdraw from the ABM treaty. Russia objected to this categorically. We believed that the treaty, the ABM 1972 treaty, was a cornerstone in the international security architecture. According to this treaty, both sides was entitled to having just one area protected against a missile attack. Russia deployed this system around Moscow and the U.S. around Grand Fox area where they had their missiles. This treaty created an atmosphere of trust between our countries and also protected us against the unilateral use of nuclear weapons by one of the two sides. This would make the aggressor vulnerable to a retaliatory strike, so we talked to the Americans, persuading them not to upset the strategic balance, but it didn't help. In 2002, the United States unilaterally withdrew from the ABM treaty, and for a long time after that, we tried to have a constructive dialogue with the Americans. We suggested working together in this area, and at a certain point it seemed to me that we could achieve a compromise, but no. All our proposals were rejected. Then we said that in order to ensure our security, we'll have to improve our modern strike capabilities. In response, they said that the United States were not developing missile defense capabilities against Russia. So it's up to you. You can do what you want. We'll just believe that you're not doing this against the United States. Where did this come from? Basically, it's obvious. After the collapse of the Soviet Union, Russia, which they identified with the Soviet Union, this is what they called it in the West, the Soviet Russia, they said, speaking about our national borders. Russia lost 23.8% of its territory, 48.5% of its population, 41% of GDP, 39.4% of its industrial potential. Almost half, 44.6% of the defensive capabilities, because the armed forces of the Soviet Union were divided between former Soviet republics. Our modern military equipment was obsolete, and the armed forces were in a pitiful condition. So we had a civil war going on in the Caucasus, and our leading uranium enrichment facilities had U.S. inspectors working there. And at a certain point, it was a big question whether we will be able to develop strategic weaponry at all, whether some even asked whether Russia was capable of servicing nuclear weapons we inherited from the Soviet Union. Russia was deep in debt and unable to fund its armed forces, and our partners probably believed that the resurgence of the economy and the defense sector of the economy of our country would be impossible in the near future. And thus, there was no need to take Russia's views into consideration. They decided that they should push forward and achieve unilateral dominance so they can dictate their will in all the other areas as well. This position, this kind of logic, is understandable based on the reality we had back then. It's our own fault. After the United States withdrew from the ABM Treaty for 15 years, we did our best to bring the Americans back to these discussions about strategic stability. And we were able to achieve a few things. We've signed the New START Treaty in 2010 between Russia and the United States on further reductions of strategic offensive arms. Yet, when implementing these plans to build the global missile defense systems, all the agreements that we achieved as a part of the New START Treaty were undermined and devalued, because as the number of nuclear charges gets reduced, one party, namely the United States, increases the number of interceptor missiles, improve their characteristics, create new deployment areas for their interceptor missiles, and eventually, if we do nothing, Russia's nuclear potential will be fully undermined. They will be able to intercept all our ballistic missiles. And in spite of all our protests, the U.S. machine is working at full speed. The conveyor is running full speed. They've deployed missile defense systems in Alaska and California. As a result of NATO eastward expansion, they've set up new two areas in Romania and Poland. The range of interceptor missiles will keep growing. They have plans to deploy such missiles in Japan and South Korea. There is also a sea-based group of five cruisers and 30 destroyers deployed in the areas close to Russia. Without any exaggeration, I can say that they are working on this project at full speed. So what have we done apart from protesting and warning? How did Russia respond to this challenge? Here's what we did. After the United States withdrew from the ABM Treaty unilaterally, we've been working hard to create new promising weaponry systems. And this enabled us to make a big step forward, creating new strategic arms. U.S. global missile defense systems is mainly against ballistic missiles. And ballistic missiles, this is the core of our nuclear deterrent, just like with other nuclear powers. This is why Russia has been developing very modest price-wise, but extremely effective systems to defeat missile defense, and all our ICBMs are equipped with such system now. Also, we have developed a new generation of missiles. Namely, currently, the Defense Ministry works together with defense companies in the space industry, and they're testing a new missile system that uses a heavy ICBM. We called it Sarmat. This new system will replace the old Voivode system that we had during the Soviet period. And Voivode was considered a highly effective weapon. Our foreign partners even used a different name for it. But Sarmat is a much more powerful system. With a payload of 200 tons, it is hard to be intercepted by missile defense capabilities. The range of this new missile and the number of warheads is higher than with Voivode. Сармат will be equipped with the
hypersonic
high-yield systems,
with
capabilities for beating missile defense systems.
This
new system can be used under any conditions. Let's now watch a video.
Воевода дальность 11,000 километров.
Voivode had the range of 11,000 kilometers, and with Sarmat, with the new system, there is no range limitation.
Как видно из видеоматериалов,
as you can see from this video, it can attack any target through the North Pole or through the via the South Pole. This is a powerful weapon, and no missile defense system will be able to withstand it. But even this is not the end. We've developed a new strategic weapons that don't use ballistic trajectory at all, which means that missile defense will be useless against it. This is what I'm going to tell you about now. This new kind of weapon, promising weapon systems that Russia has developed using new, unique technology designed by our engineers. One of such systems is a small, super powerful nuclear energy system that can be deployed in a cruise missile like X-101, a Russian missile, or U.S.-made Tomahawk missile, yet its range will be like 10 times higher, which means there is basically no limit to its range. It's a small missile with unlimited range and unpredictable trajectory that can avoid all intercept barriers, cannot be intercepted by existing or future missile defense systems.
Late in 2017,
at the Central Testing Ground of the Russian Federation, we had a successful test launch of this newest cruise missile with the nuclear power energy unit. And it achieved altitude.
So
now, after the successful test, we can start manufacturing this new kind of weapon, a strategic nuclear weapon system with a missile carrying a nuclear power energy unit. Let's now watch this video. This is how it avoids defense barriers. It has unlimited range, so it can keep going like this forever, maneuvering.
Thank you. Как вы понимаете, ничего подобного ни у кого в мире пока нет.
This is unheard of, and nobody else has such a system in the world. They may create something similar in the future, but by that time our guys will come up with new ideas as well.
Далее. Хорошо известно, что в мире активно проектируется и создаются беспилотные системы вооружения.
The whole world works actively on drones. We have unmanned submarines that move at ultra-deep levels intercontinentally with a speed that is much, much higher than the speed of modern submarines, torpedoes, and even the fastest surface ships. This is just fantastic.
Они обладают низкой шумностью, высокой маневренностью и практически неуязвимы для противника.
Средства,
которые могут им противостоять, на сегодняшний день в мире
there is no defense system in the world today that can cope with such subsurface vehicles. They can be equipped with conventional or nuclear weapons, attacking coastal defenses and infrastructure facilities. In December 2017, we've completed testing this new innovative nuclear propulsion system for this unmanned subsurface vehicle. It's extremely small and at the same time
has
its sizes 100 times less than a regular submarine, and at the same time it's more powerful, and it takes 200 times less time to get to the launch site. This enabled us to develop new nuclear systems equipped with the new nuclear charges. Let's watch the next video now.
Кстати, условные наименования этих двух новых
видов
стратегического оружия России,
крылатая
ракета глобальной дальности и беспилотного подводного аппарата пока не выбраны. Ждем предложений на сайте Министерства обороны.
We don't have the names for them yet, so you can send in your proposals to the website of the Defense Ministry.
Хорошо известно, что страна с высоким уровнем научного потенциала и передовыми технологиями, страны, активно разрабатывают так называемое гиперзвуковое оружие. Сверхзвуковая скорость измеряется, как известно, махами в честь австрийского ученого Эрнста Маха, который занимался исследованиями в этой области. Один мах — 1062 километра на высоте в час, на высоте 11 километров. Одна скорость звука — один мах. От 1 до 5
километров —
сверхзвук, от 5 и больше — гиперзвук. Обладание таким оружием, безусловно, дает серьезные преимущества в сфере вооруженной борьбы. Его мощь, могущество, как говорят
these
военные
эксперты,
могут быть огромными.
Military
а скорость делает неуязвимым для сегодняшних систем ПРО и ПВО, поскольку противоракеты по-простому сказать, их просто не догоняют.
Are not able to catch up with it.
Понятно, почему ведущие армии мира стремятся обладать таким идеальным на сегодняшний день оружием. Уважаемые друзья,
friends,
у России такое оружие
Russia now
есть.
Has such a weapon.
Уже есть. Важнейшим этапом разработки современных систем вооружений стало создание высокоточного гиперзвукового авиационно-ракетного комплекса.
Также,
как вы уже поняли, наверняка не имеющего мировых аналогов. Его испытания успешно завершены. И более того, с 1 декабря прошлого года комплекс приступил к несению опытно-боевого дежурства на аэродромах Южного военного округа. Уникальные летно-технические характеристики высокоскоростного самолета-носителя позволяют доставлять ракету в точку сброса за считанные минуты. При этом ракета, летящая с гиперзвуковой скоростью, превышающую скорость звука в 10 раз, еще и осуществляет маневрирование на всех участках траектории полета, что позволяет ей также гарантированно преодолевать все существующие и, я думаю, перспективные системы противовоздушной и противоракетной обороны, доставляя к цели на дальность более 2000 километров ядерные и обычные боезаряды. Мы назвали эту систему «Кинжал». Видео,
пожалуйста. Let's watch the next video now.
Но и это еще не все, о чем я скажу сегодня. Настоящим технологическим прорывом является создание перспективного ракетного комплекса стратегического назначения с принципиально новым боевым оснащением, планирующим крылатым блоком, испытания которого также успешно завершены. Еще раз повторю, что мы неоднократно говорили нашим американским и европейским партнерам-членам о том, что будем предпринимать необходимые меры для нейтрализации угроз, которые возникают для нас в связи с развертыванием глобальной угрозы. Говорили об этом и в ходе переговоров, и даже публично. Еще в 2004 году после учения стратегических ядерных сил, в ходе которых впервые была испытана система, о которой я сейчас говорю, на встрече с прессой я сказал, неловко себя цитировать, но просто сегодня это будет к месту. Итак, было сказано, в условиях качественного и количественного роста военного потенциала других государств, России необходим прорыв к тому, чтобы иметь оружие и технику нового поколения. В этой связи могу вас удовлетворением проинформировать о том, что в результате проведенных в ходе этих учений экспериментов, положительно закончившихся экспериментов, мы окончательно убедились и подтвердили, в недалеком будущем на вооружении российской армии ракетных войск стратегического назначения будут поставлены новейшие технические комплексы, которые в состоянии поражать цели на межконтинентальной глубине с гиперзвуковой скоростью и высокой точностью, с возможностью глубокого маневра как по высоте, так и по курсу. Должен сказать, что в том, что только что прозвучало, каждое слово имеет значение. Таких систем вооружения в данный момент нет ни у одной страны мира. Конец цитаты. Ну, конечно, каждое слово имеет значение, потому что речь шла именно о возможности обхода рубежей перехода.
We talked about missiles that are capable of bypassing, avoiding defensive barriers.
Никакой тайны из наших планов.
We made no secret of our plans. We spoke openly of what we were about to do. We wanted to motivate our counterparts. This was in 2004, like I said, amazing, but despite of all the difficulties that we faced over the years, economic and financial problems, problems with our defense industry, with our armed forces, Russia remained major nuclear power, but nobody wanted to talk to us seriously. They kept ignoring us. Nobody listened to us. So, listen to us now.
Спасибо.
Thank you.
Итак, от существующих типов боевого оснащения эта система отличается способностью совершать полеты в плотных слоях атмосферы на межконтинентальную дальность на гиперзвуковой скорости, превышающей число Маха более чем в 20 раз. При движении к цели планирующий крылатый блок, как я и говорил в 2004 году, осуществляет глубокое маневрирование, как боковое, причем на несколько тысяч километров, так и по высоте. Это делает его абсолютно
altitude-wise, which makes it completely invulnerable for any missile defense systems. It uses new composite materials, which resolves the problem of
controlled long-range
flight in plasma conditions. It goes like a meteorite towards its target, like a fireball.
Температура на поверхности изделия достигает 1600
temperature on the surface of this weapon reaches 2,000 degrees centigrade, and at the same time, it is still completely under control of the operator. Let's watch the video.
В силу понятных причин мы не можем сегодня показать истинный облик, истинный внешний вид этого изделия. Даже это сегодня имеет значение, серьезное значение. Думаю, всем это понятно. Но уверяю вас, все это есть в наличии и хорошо работает.
And all these things work very well.
Более того, what's more, предприятия промышленности России приступили к серийному производству этой системы. Этого еще одного нового вида стратегического оружия России. Мы назвали его «Авангард».
We gave this new system the name of «Авангард».
Мы хорошо знаем и о том, что ряд государств работает на создание перспективного оружия на новых физических принципах. Есть все основания полагать, что и здесь мы на шаг впереди. Во всяком случае, там, где нужнее всего. Так существенные результаты достигнуты в создании лазерного оружия. И это уже не просто теория или проекты, и даже не просто начало производства.
And that's just the beginning stages of production. Last year, we started equipping our military units with combat laser systems. I won't go into details,
it
would be premature, but specialists know what I'm talking about. Such systems significantly augment Russia's military capabilities. Let's watch this video now.
Для тех, кто интересуется военной техникой, также хотел бы тех, кто интересуется военной техникой,
также хотел бы предложить, systems, I would suggest,
попросил бы, чтобы они предложили название и этой новой техники,
your proposals for a name for this new system.
Конечно, мы еще будем заниматься доводкой, развитием, совершенствованием новейших систем оружия. И, разумеется, я сегодня сказал далеко не обо всех наших
достижениях
и перспективах разработки, но на сегодня достаточно. Особенно подчеркну. И
я бы хотел подчеркнуть одну вещь в частности.
Особо I would like to emphasize one thing in particular.
These systems that we have developed and continue to develop, these new strategic arms, is not something we just inherited from the Soviet Union. Of course, we used some of the ideas that our predecessors developed during the Soviet period. But basically, all the things I told you about today are newest developments, things that we designed in just recent years. We had dozens of design bureaus and research centers working on these things quietly, calmly, without making a show. They worked hard for a number of years on these projects. Thousands of people working on these things. Thousands of excellent researchers, scientists, engineers who love what they do.
Workers,
including a lot of young people. They all, just like our servicemen,
who performed
valiantly in combat conditions, they are the true heroes of our time.
Хочу сейчас обратиться к каждому из них и сказать.
I would like to address all those people. I would like to tell you, we will certainly give you awards and benefits and so on. And I met you personally many times. I know this is not what you're working for. You just care about ensuring our country's security. So as the head of state, as the leader of Russia, I would like to thank you for everything you did for our country. This is precisely what our country needed today.
В основе всех перспективных военных разработок, как я уже сказал, лежат выдающиеся достижения, которые могут, должны и будут в свое время использоваться в высокотехнологичных гражданских отраслях производства. Но что хочу особо отметить.
But I would like to mention one thing specifically. This unique weapon system can only be developed, designed and developed in a state that has the highest level of fundamental science, research centers, industrial facilities, labor force, and you can see now that Russia has all these assets.
Мы будем наращивать этот потенциал, концентрировать эти возможности на решении тех масштабных задач, которые стоят перед страной в экономике, в социальной сфере, в инфраструктуре. И такое уверенное, долгосрочное развитие России всегда будет надежно защищено.
Such successful development of our country will always be well protected. Each of these weapon systems is unique in its own way, but it's even more important that all these systems added together will enable our defense ministry and our general staff to develop a future defense system for our country, where each weapon system will play its own role. In addition to existing weapon systems, strategic arms,
Россия получает такую систему обороны, которая надежно обеспечит ее безопасность на длительную перспективу. Конечно, еще многое предстоит сделать в сфере военного строительства. Но уже сегодня мы с полным основанием можем заявить, что Россия создана современная, с учетом огромности нашей территории, компактная, высокотехнологичная армия, сердцем которой является преданный своей родине, готовый на любые жертвы ради своего народа, офицерский корпус.
Military officers.
Техника, оружие, даже самые современные, рано или поздно появятся в других армиях мира. Это нас абсолютно не волнует. У нас это уже есть. И будет еще лучше. Главное в другом. Таких людей, таких офицеров, как наш летчик, гвардии майор Роман Филиппов, у них не будет никогда. For example,
they will never have such people as pilot Роман Филиппов.
Надеюсь, что все, что было сказано сегодня, отрезвит любого потенциального агрессора. А такие недружественные шаги по отношению к России, как развертывание системы ПРО, приближение инфраструктуры НАТО к нашим границам и тому подобное, с военной точки зрения становятся неэффективными, с финансовой неоправданно затратными и в конечном итоге просто бессмысленными для тех, кто это инициирует и делает. Обо всем, что было сказано сегодня, мы так или иначе должны были проинформировать наших партнеров.
We have to inform our counterparts because of the commitments we've made internationally earlier. And
специалисты МИДа и Минобороны еще не раз обсудят с ними эти вопросы, если, конечно, наши партнеры этого захотят.
In the future, with our partners, if they're interested in doing so, I will only say that all this work has been conducted by us within the limits of current arms control treaties. We're not violating anything, and I'd like to emphasize specifically that this military power is not to threaten anybody. We have no plans, neither we have ever had plans to be an aggressor and attack anybody. Have never had any plans to attack anybody. We are not going to take anything away from anybody. We have everything we need. On the contrary, I'd like to emphasize, and this is very important, Russia's growing military power is just a guarantee of peace on our planet, because this military might will preserve the strategic balance, the balance of forces in the world, which has always been a key factor of international security after World War II. To this day.
А тем, кто на протяжении последних 15 лет старается раздувать гонку вооружения, пытается получить в отношении России одностороннее преимущество, вводит незаконные с международной правовой точки зрения ограничения и санкции, чтобы сдержать развитие нашей страны, в том числе в военной области, скажу,
Like
все то, чему вы пытались помешать, воспрепятствовать, проводя такую политику, уже свершилось. Сдержать Россию не удалось.
You were unable to hold Russia back.
Теперь нужно осознать эту реальность, убедиться в том, что все, что мною было сегодня сказано, это не блеф, а это не блеф, подумать, отправить на заслуженный отдых тех, кто живет в прошлом, и не в состоянии заглянуть в будущее.
Get rid of the people who cannot look into the future and keep living in the past. And stop rocking the boat called the planet Earth.
Еще одно обстоятельство. Большую озабоченность вызывают и некоторые положения обновленного обзора ядерной стратегии США, в котором расширяются возможности снижения и снижается порог применения ядерного оружия.
The threshold of using nuclear weapons.
Но мы читаем, что написано. tell us to calm down unofficially off the record,
but we are looking at the official document, and it says that now nuclear weapons can be used in response even to cyber threats.
Well, I would like to say that Russia will only use nuclear weapons when nuclear weapons are used against Russia or against its allies,
or in case of a direct aggression against Russia with conventional weapons that poses an existential threat to our nation. It's very clear and specific. So I have to say the following. Any use of nuclear weapons against Russia or its allies, small range, medium range, any kind of attack will be regarded as a nuclear attack against Russia. And in response, we will take action instantaneously, no matter what the consequences are.
Ни у кого на этот счет не должно быть никаких сомнений. Не нужно создавать для мира новых угроз, а нужно наоборот садиться за стол переговоров и вместе думать над обновленной перспективной системой международной безопасности и устойчивого развития цивилизации. Мы всегда вам об этом говорили. Все эти предложения остаются в силе. Россия к этому готова. Наша политика никогда не будет основываться на претензиях на исключительность.
We'll never be based on exceptionalism. We just protect our interests, and we also respect other countries' interests based on international law. We think that the United Nations should play the leading role. It is because of this approach that we can have equal relations with most countries around the world. As an example, I can mention our strategic partnership with the People's Republic of China, our strategic relationship with India.
We have new trends
in our relations with many countries around the world. Russia is actively working with international organizations. We are developing new groupings and structures like the CSTO, Shanghai Cooperation Organization, BRIC, the G20,
Мы заинтересованы в нормальном, конструктивном взаимодействии с США и Евросоюзом. Рассчитываем, что возобладает здравый смысл, и наши партнеры сделают выбор в пользу честного, равноправного сотрудничества. Даже если наши позиции в чем-то не совпадают, все равно мы остаемся партнерами, потому что нам вместе отвечать за сложнейшие вызовы, обеспечивать всеобщую безопасность, строить будущий мир, который становится все более взаимосвязанным, which becomes increasingly integrated. We see integration taking place all over the world together with our partners in Eurosec, will make it globally competitive grouping of countries. We'll soon have a common energy market, common oil market, we'll harmonize our financial markets and customs services. We will continue working on a greater Eurasian partnership. Весь мир проходит сейчас через переломный период, и лидером станет тот, кто готов и способен к изменениям. Тот, кто действует, идет вперед. Такую волю наша страна, наш народ проявляли на всех определяющих исторических этапах нашего развития. За последние без малого 30 лет мы добились таких перемен, для которых другим государствам понадобились столетия. The kind of transformations that would take centuries with other countries.
We are pursuing our own line, our own policy. We stay together. We'll always be like that.
Наша сплоченность – самая прочная основа для дальнейшего развития. В предстоящие годы нам надо еще больше укрепить свое единство, чтобы мы работали как одна команда, которая понимает, что перемены необходимы, и готова отдавать свои силы, знания, опыт, талант для достижения общих целей. Вызовы, большие задачи наполняют особым смыслом нашу жизнь. Нам надо быть смелыми в замыслах, в делах, в поступках, брать на себя инициативу, ответственность, становиться сильнее, а значит, приносить пользу своей семье, детям, всей стране, менять мир, жизнь страны к лучшему, создавать Россию, о которой мы вместе Russia, which we are dreaming of, then the upcoming decades, the whole 21st century, will be the time of our victories, our common success. And I believe that this is
going to be the case. Thank you.
Спасибо большое.
Thank you.
Спасибо.
Thank you.